geospatial assessment of landscape threats affecting Arkansas karst species.
Yeah, so I'm going to follow up a really cool presentation. I'm going to talk about some work that I do with the Nature Conservancy, and this was a few years back, but I think it's still relevant to what I'm doing in Arkansas as far as looking at trying to prioritize how we conserve our karst habitats. And so, I'll start with talking about back in 2003, this was about a year or so before I came on with the Nature Conservancy. At that time, in the early 2000s, across TNC, the Nature Conservancy, there was really a push to sort of develop these ecoregional plans and use those plans to prioritize how we do conservation. To sort of give us places where we focus our efforts and focus the funding that was available and work with our partners on doing that. And so there was one that was developed for the Ozarks, an Ozark ecoregional plan. And a part of that plan included our karst areas. And so, but you know, at the time, TNC wasn't really involved with as much cave conservation work as we are now. And so the data was a little bit limited. They used kind of their best judgment on what to include and how to characterize that. And what you can see is that, you know, based on, you know, the assessment, I will point to these in case anybody thought about it here. Basically, they threw all those case sites together and they identified these sort of portfolio areas where they said these are the places where some people have either the most rich caves or the most unique and rare animals, and those are the places that we need to focus our efforts. And in Arkansas, that was about, based on about 30 sites or so, you know, they threw these sort of polygons around and created these 14 conservation areas where we work, and it included, you know, 17 species total. It wasn't just our tropical biomes, those cave adapted species, it included some of our endangered bat species. But you can see it was three bats, four sort of terrestrial species, and about 10 aquatic. And so we've been using this as sort of our guiding document since 2003 on how we do our conservation work in the state. And this just kind of summarizes, you know, how we've used this and what we've kind of done in these particular areas. We've done a lot of monitoring at these endangered sites, endangered species sites for bats and cave fish and prey fish. We put gates up where we need to. Visitation is an issue. We're repairing gates because of damage. Haul out a whole bunch of different trash. We've seen holes in our own entrances. They have a detrimental impact. The cave animals are there. We do a lot of groundwater monitoring to just track sort of what's going on and establish baselines for the groundwater health that's there. And then based on this plan, we focused conservation efforts into acquisition projects where we identify caves and we've tried to acquire the landscape considered to protect the cave for perpetuity. And it's not just us that's doing that, it includes our federal and state agency partners that also, you know, they're the ones that create fat wallets and have a lot more money than we do. And so usually we're partnering for them to do that. But the field, you know, this has been a really nice plan to use and sort of help us focus while we're doing that. We've moved a lot of money. But you know, at the same time we've been doing this, you know, they hired me, I've been working on these things, but I also like to go caving and I want to see what else is out there. So over the same time frame, we pulled together other information that was available on Arkansas for caves. We did a lot more additional cave surveys, and so we were finding new species, we were finding range extensions. So we ended up over the last 10 years just generating a whole bunch of new information that wasn't being captured in this 2003 plan that we had. And we had these new species that were described. So, you know, of course, TNC loves to have plans. That's what we like to do best. And they encouraged me to think about how to use this information to reprioritize the kind of work that we're doing specifically. I agreed to do that. I didn't agree to do sort of the broader Ozarks at this point, but that's something that we're interested in doing. One of the things we talked about and thought about was that if we're going to have this sort of new conservation priority plan for how we're working on cave animals in Arkansas, we need to add some additional aspects to that. And so we wanted to include all this information that we've gotten, whether it was old literature that we missed, whether it was new information that we got over the last 10 years. But because, you know, just because we have extremely biodiverse places, and we have a limited amount of funds, we have a limited amount of time, and we want to focus that on those places that are really important to work at. And so I wanted to incorporate an aspect of threat to what was on so that I can make a decision, or our partners can make a decision on, we want to spend X amount of money at something that's really highly threatened and try to protect that site versus one that's nothing going on and maybe we can work on that later. So this new plan, we want to incorporate that threat into it, so we did a modeling technique to do that. And modeling technique allows us to make sort of comparisons, so it's relative comparisons between sites. So, you know, we use these geospatial data sets to do that. When you think about threat associated with a site, as an example, like an aquatic site, you may have defined a recharge area around it. You may be able to really go close to that cave and figure out, walk around on the surface and determine, well, there's a dump full of stuff here, there's a chicken house sitting over here. But if you're looking across northern Arkansas, you're looking across a broad landscape in sort of a way to assess threat across all of those in a quicker way to kind of get a broad general way view of what may be occurring there. And that's kind of this modeling exercise that we did, allowed us to do that and allowed us to prioritize what we did like that. So I'm gonna go in probably deeper than you'll want about the modeling technique. I'll try to go quick, but if you remember the 2003 plan, you know, we had much less sites, so we kicked this up to 57 species. We'll talk about the actual cave animals first. You know, we bumped the bats up, included another bat relative to the earlier plan. This is where the big difference was, is that the original plan had 4 species. We bumped this up to 28 species. Same with the aquatic, we bumped this up to 25, so we're capturing a lot more of those rare species in the state. We split these into 3 categories because that allowed us to model specific to an agency wants to know just information about bats. Now we can share that sort of threat priority component to that. If you're interested in aquatic stuff, you can see that. Well, initially we had very few sites in Arkansas. So, you know, over this time frame, we bumped that up to almost about 300 sites. So we characterize those sites based on those species categories. So if it had these rare bats in it, it was a bat cave. If it had aquatic animals in it, it was an aquatic cave. And if it had terrestrial animals in it, but that in that cave that had terrestrial animals didn't also have bats or didn't also have aquatics, we characterized it as a terrestrial site. So if you're going to assess threat around the cave and don't have some, you know, you don't have like a recharge delineation which really locks in where water is coming from that site, you have to come up with an assessment area. You want to figure out sort of roughly what's the area around the cave that's going to have this threat impact. And that's going to vary depending on the species group. So for bats, we design assessment areas for, as an example, for bats, you know, for our habitat threats, that was a 5-mile radius, so any threat within 5 miles associated with habitat would have an impact there. And that's based on bat research that's shown that for a lot of our cave bats, they're typically foraging. They're using surface habitat within a 5-mile radius around the site. Now, the other aspect that we wanted to model threat-wise for bats was visitation. So what's the proximity of humans to that site? Because the more humans you've got in there, the easier access to the site. The more potential that people are going to be going in there and disturbing the bats. We felt like 5 miles was probably a little bit too small because we can drive a lot of places now, and so we bumped that up to a 10-mile radius around the site. For the terrestrial species, the only threat that we really modeled was the human component of that, so visitations, proximity to the sites, and so we modeled that, and we used the same 10-mile radius. For our aquatic sites, we're modeling both water quality and quantity. And if we had the information, because some of our sites have endangered cave aquatic species, so we have those are cave fish and we have cave crayfish. These are endangered species, so there's been a lot more money focused on conservation work there. So in those instances, we have recharge area delineations, people that put dye in the ground and determine what part of the landscape contributed water to that system. So in those instances, we use that recharge area as our assessment. But there's a ton of other aquatic caves that we didn't have that information for, so we had to come up with a way to assess the water contribution to that site. So we used the natural hydrology data set that's available, geospatial data set that's available, and that's on a sub-watershed. It's divided up in sub-watersheds, and then we modeled, we sort of broke that down even smaller and we sort of catchment sizes, which you can see as an example here. This is a surface catchment that the cave itself fell into. And so that worked reasonably well, but I actually did go through for those aquatic sites that were just using the catchment area. I actually went and looked at the cave, thought about the size of the cave, whether it had been there or not, and sort of confirmed on the maps whether or not that catchment size was large enough to ensure that we were capturing everything that was there. But for the most part, it just ended up being one catchment area that contributed to water. So we're going to model threats sort of across an entire landscape. You've got to come up with a way to do that rapidly. If you've got funding, your funders are going to want you to do it in a year or two. So we decided to use geospatial data sets that are available out here for Arkansas to derive our threat metrics from. These sort of been, we used 25 of spatial data sets that we have for Arkansas that are across all of northern Arkansas for that. And so if you remember those assessment areas, you can think of that outline of that assessment area as like a cookie cutter. So if you take these geospatial data sets and you put them on the map, and then you just take that assessment area and stamp it, and it cuts out everything within that assessment area for the particular geospatial data set. And then you derive your score and your values from that. And this will become a little more clear later. And so when you do that, as an example, say you're interested in how many miles of road you have within an assessment area. You cut that out, and then within an ArcGIS platform, you can calculate the number of miles of road that are over the top of that assessment area associated with that cave. Well, that's your raw score. And then we normalize that so that you don't have all these wide range of numbers, just to a zero to one scale. And that allows you to basically take all of those scores from those geospatial sets and add them all up into a composite overall score on a zero to one rank. And so ultimately, when you smash all this up in this model, for each of those 297 sites, you have a one overall threat score on a zero to one scale. And that allows you to prepare a threat that you find in your cave with threats in northeastern Arkansas, one in northwestern Arkansas, at that relative level. So we tried to look at the spatial data sets that were available and derive kind of these habitat threats and visitation threats from that. And I'm going to go through these quickly, but for the bats, we were looking mainly at two different things. Threats associated with the habitat, where they're foraging on the surface, and threats associated with visitation. And these are the different metrics that we derived from that. The terrestrial threats, as I mentioned, were the same for the terrestrial species. So human visitation came from just basically the number of people that were within that area. So the more people you've got living close to a cave, the higher the risk for people actually going to that cave as well. Same thing with roads, the number of roads, the more the roads that are there, the easier it is to get there. And the closer an actual road is to the site, it allows for all lazy people to go after something. So we're trying to capture different ways of assessing what impact visitation might be having on the site. So the aquatic threats there was more to think about there because we needed to think about water quality as well as water quantity on the impact there. And so we looked at metrics associated with sediment, we looked at metrics associated with nutrients that might impact the water quality of the caves. We looked at metrics associated with potential pollutants that might be introduced into the cave systems. And we looked at hydrologic alterations, so the amount of impervious surface that was within that recharge area might alter the amount of water that's getting in there or how the water is flushing through based on precipitation events. The one slight difference with the aquatic threats is that you can model a threat on a landscape. And that threat may occur there, but you have to capture the fact that the soil may be filtering some of those pollutants, may keep those pollutants from getting into the groundwater quite as quick. And so you need to sort of come up with this, a model of a landscape vulnerability. And so we did that. And I have a much better map. I just wanted to show the background of that. The EPA has developed a groundwater vulnerability modeling technique called DRASTIC, and incorporates all of these different aspects into how to model the vulnerability of a landscape. So you've got depth of water, recharge, where the water is coming from, the type of media, the aquifer media, the kinds of soils that you have, the topography of the landscape that you're looking at, as well as the, you know, the impact of the Vado zone. And then we modified this, so we call it DRASTIC with K. The original was DRASTIC with C, because the original model wasn't developed for karst landscapes. But we wanted to capture the fact that for a karst landscape, sinkholes, photolinements, those kind of things allow water to infiltrate much more rapidly than on a non-karst landscape. But we were limited to, we needed to have data sets available for all of Northern Arkansas, and the only things that we had were photolinements and faults for the air for across Northern Arkansas. So we used those two as our part of our drastic model. I'll show a map of this vulnerability map for shortly. But I want everybody to be awake for this part, because we're going to have a quiz at the end. I have all this works together. But what I wanted to show is, I talked about that our model is additive. So you develop the raw scores, and you begin to add the composite scores together. And that's basically what's going on. So you have, here are all the metrics associated with water quality and quantity. And they, you see, they're rolling up into sort of these broader categories. And then all of that combines into sort of an overall score. Here's our we talked about our drastic, our vulnerability modeling. So you can have insults to the landscape here, and you have some filtering capacity by the land here. When you add those two together, you get the overall vulnerability. And then, because we know that this human visitation is an issue regardless of the animals that are in there, then we take that visitation component and add that to this vulnerability component, and that gives us sort of an overall threat score for the aquatic species. And you can see how those kind of all combine together until you end up with an overall bat score, an overall terrestrial score, and then an overall aquatic score. And I'll show some examples of sort of how that adds up. So for the bats, you come up with these. So just the threat score for the bats, you can look at, you know, if you're interested in what you know, across the landscape, you know, are there caves that we think modeling have a higher threat associated with loss of habitat. We can sort of see those here. The red dots are those with the highest threats. The green dots are those with the lowest threat. I apologize if anybody's colorblind and you can't see these. You just have to believe me. And so, but you can see how you can take that overall score at the habitat level, you can add that to the overall scores for how easy it is, how threats associated with human visitation, and you combine that into an overall map here, and you can begin to see some patterns for the bats, like where we think the caves are that might have a higher amount of threat associated with them. You can see here in Northwest Arkansas, where I live, associated with this, the major interstate, you have you know, Bentonville here, which is the home of Walmart, so there's lots of people in here, lots of issues here. You can see, but overall, you know, the pattern is kind of those bat caves with high levels of threat dispersed across Northern Arkansas. There are some concentrations, but you can find those all the way across the state. The terrestrial community, you kind of see the same thing. This has had quite as many dots because this is only the caves that had those terrestrial animals that were in sites without bats or without aquatic species. So for capturing that in the other few models, you just don't see that. There's some of us spend a lot of time here because there's not a lot of pretty dots to come up with patterns. But in general, you can see, like the bats, there seems to be something going on here in Northwest Arkansas relative to the rest of the state. Same kind of thing for the aquatic sites. You look at the overall score for just water quality threats, not a lot of issues. You know, in general, there's some moderate level of threat. A lot of the sites, there's not a lot of threat going on, so those are probably in pretty good condition. When you overlay that onto, remember my drastic with a K model, that's what this is. So this is the landscape's ability to filter water going into the karst environments. And you can see some patterns just on this. Concentration of where it's easier for water to get into the surface here, the subsurface here, and the same thing over here. Broadly in the general middle of the state, it's hard to see at this scale of map, but if you were to zoom in, you can see that, you know, associated with the creeks and the drainages and things, you have a higher level of risk associated with stuff getting in there. But if you match those two up, then you get sort of a sensitivity to water quality, as I talked about. You can take that and you add it to visitation threats of where humans are, and you get sort of a broad overall threat score for the aquatic species. And again, Northwest Arkansas pops up as a place where if caves are there and they have these species that we're concerned about, there's a reasonably good chance that they're going to be threatened based on this modeling technique. So we did this modeling and we're using to kind of address how we were thinking about protecting sites. So, what this tells us is that while, there's a lot of issues going on here in Northwest Arkansas, we really need to look at these particular caves closer, spend more time and energy and money trying to protect the sites. One of the things that, the way that we can use this data, the way that we are using this data is to kind of help prioritize these actions, these conservation actions. And so, and you can do it in a couple of different ways. You can do it in a bunch of different ways. So there's tons of ways to mine this modeling and use it. And I'm just going to go through just a couple of examples of how we're doing that. So we know that some of the back sites are threatened. So here's the lowest threat, and that's green, the highest threat is red. And you can sort of throw up all the bat caves on here, and you can also look at which bat caves have a higher amount of species. And you can additionally, you can look at sites that are in Northwest Arkansas, or the open diamonds, or the canyons and black diamonds. And you can kind of look at, are there particular caves that we really need to focus an effort on. So you look at Cave Springs Cave here, that pops out as a site that you'll want to continue to work at. That's in Northwest Arkansas. It has several different of our bats that we're interested in. It also has a lot of other species that the state is interested in. So this kind of helps us organize our thoughts around what sites and where in the state will work. You do the same kind of thing with aquatic species. Same kind of pattern here, same kind of use. So open diamonds are the Benton and Washington County sites. Other counties are the dark. And even that general pattern that we're seeing, so the red dots here, highly threatened. You kind of see that in the same way here. But so it tells us what this, as I mentioned, what this model does is it sort of shows us those places that are really threatened that we may want to work at. We may want to spend a lot of time in. But it also can show us where those low-hanging fruit are, that say we have a really biodiverse cave, it's got interesting species in it, maybe it has rare endemic species in it, but it's not very threatened at all. But maybe it's unique enough that we should try to protect it now as opposed to while it's in a good, healthy system and state, as opposed to waiting for it to all go to hell and then having enough a bunch of money into it later and maybe not work. So this technique can identify those low-hanging fruit. And I want to come back to this particular low-hanging fruit here, Mushi Cave, in a minute and just talk briefly about that. But what this technique identifies is that, here's Mushi Cave, here's a cave with a little threat with a lot of interesting species in it, and maybe we want to work there to protect that site. So, in addition, if you can take this modeling exercise and you can drill down to the species level, you can look at different things too. You can look at, particularly for gray bats as an example, which gray bat caves should we be working at? So here on the y-axis is the total number of bats, and this is in the thousands. And you can see threat here. You can see, open diamonds are caves that were hibernacula, black diamonds are maternity sites, and these are other sites that gray bats use. And you can see that for the most part, most of our gray bat sites are not threatened so much in general, as opposed to, Cave Springs continues to pop out here high. But this gives us a way to begin to look and see, are there sites that are consistently high up here above? And, you know, this, the technique, as I just showed on that map, works great if you've got, like, for gray bats, you know, it's an endangered species. We've got lots of years of survey work. We've got lots of abundance estimates. We've got lots of numbers. But for a species where we don't have good time series of data, this technique can actually get at, you know, overall across the state, you know, how are the populations doing using frequency analysis. And so you can see that for a bulk of the sites where we have Dorado salamanders, they're in sites with a pretty low threat score. So what that demonstrates to me is that if the state says, pick the top 10 cave species in the state that we need to work on for the next 10 years, I can look at it and say, well, Dorado salamanders are not one we have to work on because the threats appear to model pretty low. Let's spend that time, energy, and money on something that is much more high of a threat. And so we've been using this, we've been working with the agencies to implement kind of how to do this. And, you know, as I mentioned, in Northwest Arkansas, a threat model identified that there's a lot of sites that seem to have a high impact to me. And so, and particularly a lot of those sites are aquatic sites, and that actually was an impetus for getting funding, which is what we're doing right now, is we picked 8 sites here, and we're collecting monthly water quality samples of those sites to try and establish a baseline of a healthy water quality health in this area. Can I just get it on? So, you know, in addition, another one of the outcomes, so you know, the modeling itself just gets some additional money to try and begin to address some of these issues. But the other thing that it's done is it showed us that 2003 plan was really outdated and we needed to, you know, as you can see overlaid here, all of our dots are the dots that we used, almost 300 sites. These old polygons are from the 2003 map. And you can see that those old areas that we're supposed to be working on really don't capture the diversity of sites in Arkansas very well. And the other thing that this identified, particularly for Arkansas, is we've got these places, these large areas, where we have absolutely no data at all. We don't even have any. We know that there's caves there, but we never visit them to see what caves are. So focusing effort on those places will give us a better picture of what animals might be observed. And I'll touch on this just briefly. This is my low-hanging fruit in this exercise. Identify the Fushi Cave as a place that maybe we could protect. And it turns out that here's the cave right here. When we looked in more deeply, we delineated the recharge area. We determined that there were 2 landowners that owned about 80% of the recharge area. And so using the funding available, the state actually bought that. So now it's a natural area. So that site, 80% of the recharge area, all the cave passage, is now a protected site in Arkansas. And so we've sort of reduced the risk of that cave and those species that are there of having any risk and potential threats in the future. And it's home to this endemic cave snail. It's the only place in the world that snail is known from. And finally, you know, we've done this for Arkansas. We just wrapped up the same technique and process for Oklahoma. And we're pursuing funding to do the same thing for Missouri, so that ultimately we'll have the whole ecoregion done, and we'll be addressing some of these issues more at the ecoregional level. And I just thank the game. The money that came for this modeling was from the Arkansas Game and Fish Commission. And don't ask me any questions about the specifics of the GIS modeling, because I had 2 crack guys that were doing all the work. They're not here to answer those questions. But, you know, it was pretty GIS intensive. I will take a quick question if you've got a minute.